Hey everyone, Ari Fuld here. We're broadcasting out of the beautiful rolling hills of Judea, Israel. And we have a shorter but very exciting lesson we're going to be talking about today from this week's Torah portion. So before we do begin, if you're tuning in, definitely say hello. Let me know where you're tuning in from. I always love to see how far, you know, this is going. So first of all, say hello, and again, let me know where you're tuning in from, and give me a thumbs up, by the way. I am so stupid. Hold on. Give me a second. 1 second. All right, here we go. We're back in business. All right. So first of all, say hello, everyone, if you're tuning in. Let me know where you're tuning in from. I apologize for that. I just wanted to make sure the volume was on. We're going to try to keep this a little bit short because Shabbos is coming in. And we are going to talk about something that is probably one of the most practical pieces of advice for today. We're talking about handing over leadership, talking about what is a leader, what is the definition of a real leader. And so Moshe Rabbeinu is about to die, and he has to hand over the leadership to the next person in line, which, according to God's command, of course, is Yehoshua bin Nun. And you would expect that when you're handing over the leadership to the next person in line, that you would give them advice on how to survive and how to be successful, right? Whether it's how to survive with the nation, how to survive with God, how to survive in the desert, different kinds of advice that would help the next leader succeed. And apparently, if you read the parsha in the beginning, Shabbat Shalom to everyone. Thank you for tuning in. Everyone, if you're tuning in, please let me know if you're showing it out. And of course, we'll give you a loud shout out right here. So you would think of some like positive advice and, you know, give them confidence. You can do this. Everything's great. Everything will be wonderful. Shabbat Shalom, Stephen. Well, the parsha starts out. Moshe goes, first of all, he doesn't even talk to Yehoshua. He doesn't go to Yehoshua and say, Yehoshua, I got to talk to you. Step into my office for 1 second. We got to talk. Okay, I want to give you the reins. I want to give you control. I want to pass the leadership over to you. But there are a couple of things that you need to know. That's not what happens. It says Moshe Rabbeinu says all these things in front of the whole nation of Israel. Okay, well, what does he say? What does he say to the nation of Israel the second before he's going to die? And the second he has to hand the responsibility over to another. And you have to remember, by the way, that when Moshe Rabbeinu went up on Har Sinai, on Mount Sinai, and didn't come down even a couple of hours late, that Bnei Israel so missed his presence that they built the golden calf. So what does the leader at the time say to the nation of Israel when he's about to die and give over the leadership to the next person in line? He says, Moshe Rabbeinu says to Israel, Ben me'avetzim shana anuchi, I'm 120 years old, hayom, today, lo uchal od latzet levo, I can't do it anymore. I can't do it anymore. V'adonai amar elai, furthermore, God said to me, lo tavor et yarden hazeh, you're not passing the Jordan River, you're not going to the land of Israel. I mean, you know, if someone doesn't understand or can read it within, you know, within the words, it really sounds, I don't want to say ridiculous, but ridiculous. I mean, you're about to die. You're handing it over to the next leader. And instead of, you know, charging him with confidence that everything will be okay, what do? You say, I can't do this anymore. I'm 120 years. I can't do this anymore. And God also told me that I'm not going to the land of Israel. Well, you know, if Moshe Rabbeinu can't do this, then the nation is certainly not going to have confidence in anyone else. Just an update right now from the news. I'm sorry for interrupting. A news update right now. A terrorist tried to infiltrate Israel from the Gaza Strip and was terminated by IDF soldiers. So thank God he didn't get in, and good job to IDF soldiers. But the question again is the following. Bnei Israel, the nation of Israel, they have their eyes on Moshe Rabbeinu. Moshe Rabbeinu is Moses, if they don't know. And they believe in Moshe Rabbeinu, almost more than they believe in God. We know that. Again, Moshe Rabbeinu goes up to Har Sinai, gets lost, or doesn't come down, and Bnei Israel get completely lost. So instead of saying it'll be okay, Moshe Rabbeinu says, I can't do this anymore. And God's punishing me. Now, if there's any way to hurt the confidence of the nation who is supposed to be believing in the next leader in Yehoshua, Moshe Rabbeinu seemingly just destroyed that. He did the worst thing one can possibly do. He says, me, Moshe Rabbeinu, right? The man you all believe in and took it out of Egypt and all the tremendous miracles, I can't do it anymore. Well, if you can't do it, then Yehoshua certainly can't do it. He just stripped the nation's belief in Yehoshua. And then his second line is, and God punishing me. He's not allowing me in the land of Israel. Well, if Moshe Rabbeinu is getting punished for what? For hitting a rock, let's say, if we can read it on the most simplest level, then how is anyone else going to do any better? At Moshe Rabbeinu, we know that it says there's not going to be a prophet that will rise like Moshe Rabbeinu ever again in history. So if he got punished by God for doing such a small, seemingly small act, Yehoshua's not any better than him, so he's also going to get punished. I mean, it seems like the worst possible thing you could say to a nation right before you die. And then the next passage, Adonai Elecha, Kadosh Baruch Hu, God, Hu Over Lefanecha, He is going ahead of you. Hu Yashmid Et Hagoyim Ha'Elem Lefanecha V'Yirishtam. He will destroy the nations who are coming against you, and you will be able to inherit the land of Israel. Well, what is he forgetting to mention here? There's no name of Yehoshua here, right? It doesn't say Yehoshua at all. It says Hashem, God will go in front of you and he'll fight the wars. And it says, and then after he said that God will do that, it says, Yehoshua hu over lefanecha kasher diber Adonai. And Yehoshua will be in front of you as God commanded. Very, very strange order of the psukim here. First it says to Bnei Israel that Kadosh Baruch Hu is going to fight for you, and you will inherit the land. He'll destroy the nations that are trying to fight you. And then it says, Yehoshua will go in front of you as God commanded. Well, if God's going in front of the nation of Israel, then what do we need Yehoshua for? And why did he go, why did he tell us all about his lack of confidence a passage ago? What purpose did that serve besides breaking the confidence of the nation of Israel? I appreciate everyone for sharing. Thank you. And then he goes on and he says that God will do to you like he did to Sichon, Ulog Malchei Amori. He destroyed the Amorites. Ularzam, we took over their land. Ashe Shmidotam, he destroyed the Amorites for attacking Israel. Unetanam Adonai lefanechem, and God will give you these nations in front of you. Vasitelem kachol mitzvah shetiviti etchem, and you must do to them like all the commandments that he commanded in the Torah. Chizku v'imtzu, tells the nation of Israel, be strong and brave. Al tiru, don't be fearful. Val tarzu, makares. Don't be fearful in front of them. He's not going to leave you alone. He's not going to stop, and he'll take care of you. Right? So again, the question is asked, why did Moshe Rabbeinu talk about his lack of confidence a passage ago if it's all in HaKadosh Baruch Hu, all in God's control? And then, after he speaks to Bnei Israel, you want to do it now?
Yeah.
Come here. All right. Sorry, my daughter's going away for Shabbat. Just have to give her a blessing. Okay, so, and then after he strips the confidence of the nation. He says he didn't succeed. He said God punished him. Then he said God's going to go in front of you. He's talking to the whole nation. He's missing one very important person that he has to talk to right now. Who is that? It's Yehoshua. Joshua. And the next pasuk Zayin says, "Vayikra Moshe Yehoshua." He finally calls Yehoshua. Finally calls Joshua. Now, what does Moshe Rabbeinu say to Yehoshua, to Joshua? He doesn't talk to him in private, by the way. He doesn't say, "Again, come into my office. Let me give you some hints on how to rule the nation. Let me give you some hints how to fight the wars." No, he does this in front of the entire nation of Israel. Chazak ve'emat. He says, "Be strong and be brave." You will tavo means to come, right? Tavi means to bring. Very strange language here. Tavo boina means to come here. Tavi means to bring. So it says here, you will make this nation come into Israel the way that God promised their forefathers. And you will, tanchilena comes from what hitnachaliot, and you will settle the land, settle them in the land. Very strange wording here, right? You will make the nation come into the land, instead of you will bring the nation into the land. And then he says, "V'adonai hu alech lefanecha, hu yeimach, lo yapecha v'lezveka, lo tira lo tichat." That's it. The conversation's over. There's no advice for Yehoshua. No advice whatsoever. So what's going on here? So, first of all, the way I explained the beginning passage is that Moshe Rabbeinu says, I can't do this anymore. 120 years old and I can't do this anymore. And God punished me. So obviously, that is not what the Torah is trying to say. Because if it was what the Torah is trying to say, Moshe Rabbeinu, was he able to split the sea? Was he able to do the 10 plagues in Egypt? Was he able to do anything? No, it was all a Kadosh Baruch Hu, it was all God. So what do you mean I can't do this anymore? So the explanation here is that he doesn't have permission to do this anymore. Moshe Rabbeinu, the reason he can't do this is not because he's weak. Remember when Moshe Rabbeinu was anointed by Kadosh Baruch Hu to bring the Jews out of Egypt, he said, I can't talk, I can't this. And the Kadosh Baruch Hu said, I didn't ask you what you can't do. I'm anointing you on this position to do what you got to do. So to say that Moshe Rabbeinu now is saying I'm weak is a little bit ridiculous to believe that. That means literally. But he's saying, I can't go anymore because God said I'm not allowed to cross the Jordan. It's not that he's weak. He's saying, I can do it if I wanted to, but I'm not allowed to. And therefore, he's saying that the reason that he can't do this anymore get the door. The reason that he can't do it anymore is because God said that you're not allowed to go in. And this is why he has to give the reins over. Now, what does he say to Yehoshua? What does he say to Joshua? Or what does he say to the nation first? He doesn't mention Joshua. What does he say to the nation? He's trying to teach him something extremely important. You know, in the Agadash of Pesach, in the book they read on Passover, we read a full book of the story of the Exodus from Egypt, of getting out of the land of Egypt. And guess who is not mentioned in that book even once? Moshe Rabbeinu, Moses, is not mentioned in that book even once. Not even once. In the entire book that we read that celebrates the exit from Egypt, who Moshe Rabbeinu was the leader who did so, it's not mentioned at all. He's not mentioned even once. And why? The same reason why we don't know where Moshe Rabbeinu is buried. The reason we don't know where Moshe Rabbeinu is buried, according to the Mepharshim, the Jewish explanation sages, is because people would go and worship him at his grave. And that's a mistake according to Judaism. Because there's only one source of success and failure. And that's a Kadosh Baruch Hu, that's God. And so the idea is he's saying to B'nai Israel, yes, he's not calling Yehoshua first, because Yehoshua is important, but he's not the leader's only as good as his followers. And no matter what a good leader Yehoshua might be, if B'nai Israel don't follow the law, don't follow the Torah, he will not succeed. We saw that in his war that he fought the Ai, where they lost, because somebody took some of the loot. So the idea is he doesn't talk to Yehoshua first, because Yehoshua comes second. First comes the nation, and first comes the Torah and the commandments. So what happens is, he says to the nation, look, Kadosh Baruch will take care of you, God will take care of you, but you have to follow the Torah. And Yehoshua will be there also. He will be there also, but your success in entering the land of Israel and being successful will only happen if you follow laws. And then he calls Yehoshua, and he doesn't say to him, this is how to be successful. No, what does he say? He says, Chazak ve'ematz, be strong and be brave. Ki atat tavo. You're not bringing, you're not going to bring the nation of Israel to the land of Israel. It's not up to you. It's not up to Yehoshua. The nation has to bring themselves to the land of Israel. That takes moral codes. It takes courage and strength. Yehoshua's the leader. It says he will make them come to the land of Israel. The bringing in is not up to Yehoshua. And so he's saying to them that God promised Nishbad, Avotam, God promised the land to the forefathers. And therefore, he will succeed. But not because he's Yehoshua and not because Moshe Rabbeinu was Moshe Rabbeinu. No. Because at the end of the day, the reshut of Hatzlacha or Kishalon, success or failure, is up to a Kadosh Baruch Hu alone. And therefore, all the advice it's giving has nothing to do with the personality. Yehoshua is this kind of person and therefore succeed. No. Has nothing to do with that. In fact, if God wanted to pick the worst person to take the Jews out of Egypt, he couldn't have picked the worst person than Moshe Rabbeinu. A man who had, by his own had no confidence, who apparently had some kind of speech impediment, was an outcast from his family, who grew up in the house of Paro, right? He didn't grow up in a religious Jewish home. He grew up in the house of the man who was responsible for the bondage of the nation of Israel. So he couldn't depict a worse person. But that's exactly the point. The leader is not a leader by his own, you know, I was, what do they say now in America? That if you're born, you're, what's the word they use? I can't remember the word. I'll remember it in a second. You're born into a family, and therefore you're important. That's not the way it works in Judaism at all. So Yehoshua is giving the same advice to Bnei Israel. Yehoshua will be there as a leader, but it's not up to him. It's up to you. It's up to the nation of Israel. David HaMelech, by the way, privileged. That's what I was saying, privileged. David HaMelech, by the way, he wasn't the firstborn, King David. He wasn't the secondborn. He wasn't the thirdborn, fourthborn, fifth, or sixth. And when Natan, the Navi, came to Yishai, King David's father, who, by the way, is buried in Hebron, and said to him, show me your son, because he's going to be king. So Yishai brought the first, the second, and third. He said, no, no, no. Show me that one in the field who's like hanging out with the sheep and doing nothing. That's the king. Because it's important for a leader to understand that their effort is very important. You have to, your responsibility and effort is extremely important. But success and failure is not necessarily up to you. And this was the message that Moshe Rabbeinu was giving the nation of Israel and Yehoshua together. He said, Yehoshua, you are guaranteed to succeed in bringing the nation into the land of, in having them come to the land of Israel. But at the end of the day, the message that Moshe Rabbeinu was giving the nation of Israel, and also to Yehoshua, to Joshua, was the idea that the only way that you can succeed is not based on a Moshe Rabbeinu and Moses, and it's not based on a Joshua. It's based on you, the nation of Israel. If you're following the Torah, if you're keeping the Torah, you're following the moral code of the Torah, you will succeed. And if you don't, you won't. That's the bottom line. All right, everyone, we're about done here. I want to remind everyone that November, coming to the States on a speaking tour. So I have some people who have called me already and closed down dates. We still have some dates open. North America, it'll be from the 2 weeks, the second week in November, second and third week in November. So we're talking about Israel. We're talking about reclaiming the narrative, fighting for truth, how to destroy the anti-Israel propaganda. So if you want to set something up in your area, shoot me a private message. I'll send you the flyer and all the information. You can bring it over to the people who are responsible in your area, the go-getters, who, to get things set up. And we'll do it. All right, everyone. Wishing you all well. Shabbat shalom. Have an awesome weekend, everyone. This is Ari Fuld from the beautiful rolling hills of Judea, Israel. Don't forget to hit that share button. And if you wouldn't mind, on the Ari Fuld Israel Defense page, click on that like button. Let's get the likes. Get the likes up to 20,000. All right, everyone. Take care. Have an awesome, awesome weekend from the beautiful rolling hills of Judea, Israel.